Kia ora, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Ko Shona Sangster toku ingoa, ko Dun Ishtin toku maunga, ko Leith toku awa, no Rakiura aho. Ka tangi te titi, ka tangi te kaka, ka tangi hoki aho. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Hi everyone, my name's Shona Sangster, as I said. I'm visiting from Stewart Island. My work is with the Stewart Island Rakiura Community and the Environment Trust. I actually grew up in Auckland and my descent hails back to Scotland, which is where some of those place names are from. Welcome to our presentation today. I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about the Community Environment Trust on Stewart Island and Rakiura that I'm the chair of and what it is we do down there. All right, I thought I'd start with a little introduction to Stewart Island. So we are right down the bottom of New Zealand, the southernmost island. We're the third largest island. We're 30 k's off the South Island, 1,746 square kilometres and 410 permanent residents. It's a place that's attractive to young families and retired folk alike. We have 15 preschoolers and 35 primary school children in our one primary school. High school students go to boarding school. Most people juggle a few jobs to make ends meet and are very flexible over the high points of the tourism season and also peaks around the fishing industry. We've had a really great year for tourism. It's been wonderful for us post-COVID, unlike some other places. Lots of people have decided this is the year, this is the time to visit us down on Rakiura. Our industry and population used to be larger. We used to have up to 5,500 residents doing over multiple settlements, sealing, whaling, timber milling, mining, fishing. But now we're pretty much concentrated into a small corner of the island and around the township of Oban. There's a long history of conservation on Stewart Island. It goes all the way back to Charles Trail, who was a The Trails were an old island family who came from Orkney originally. Lots of early settlers came from Scotland. Charles Trail declared Ulva a reserve for the preservation of natural game and flora in 1899. So that's fairly early in the conservation game. A descendant of his, Roy Trail, was an early Forest Service ranger and an early kind of conservationist and did a lot of work to try and basically discourage people from eating the native wildlife. In 1987, the Forest Service and Lands and Surveys merged to become the Department of Conservation. The Department of Conservation is a very big player on Stewart Island. They employ quite a few people, and 85% of our land area is national park or some kind of conservation land. So they have a big role to play in managing that. SIRCET, which is the Environmental Trust Stewart Island Rakiura Community and Environment Trust, formed in 2002, which was the same year that the national park was opened. And we also have a predator-free Rakiura group. We're different to that. There's often a little bit of confusion, but we're a kind of different beast, which I will explain in the next slide. And we've also recently achieved dark sky sanctuary status. Conservation on the island in action today. We've got quite a few groups. Referred to the Department of Conservation. There's also the Ulva Island Charitable Trust. Ulva Island is considered now to be the jewel in the Department of Conservation's crown. And if you've visited, it's amazing, pest-free island with a real wealth of bird life and wildlife. Predator-free Rakiura is a recent kind of development. That's a group that's come together actually out of a document originally that was produced by our organisation, SIRCET. We commissioned the first island-wide rat eradication scoping document just to see what would be possible. And then the predator-free movement's kind of come along and pick that up and run with it. There's also a fenced sanctuary on Stewart Island called Mamaku Point, which is 172 hectares behind a predator fence. It's a great place to come and visit. We also have Rakiura Māori Lands Trust, who are a major Māori landowner in the region. They are doing some wonderful restoration work on the Neck Oneki at the moment and have received some provincial growth fund money to look at sustainable tourism development in their on their lands. The Rakiura Hunter Camp Trust, that there's quite a lot of hunting on Stewart Island. It's a big part of our industry, is people travelling to New Zealand, to Stewart Island to hunt. And they encourage all their hunters to not just hunt the whitetail and the Virginian deer, but also to do a bit of conservation while they're there and set traps around the hunt, around the huts they were staying in, and catch feral cats and things and rats and things. We also have a really, really clued up Enviro school, which is the Halfmoon Bay school, and some other groups, Rakiura Marine Guardians. We play, SIRCET really is involved above the water. Rakiura Marine Guardians take a lot of care about what's happening in the in our oceans, and they look at things like marine reserves and appropriate catch limits and all those issues. So a little bit more about who we are. SIRCET, we've been around since 2002. Our genesis was actually two things. One of them was a waste management issue. At the time, the council was looking at getting rid of the old kind of dump on Stewart Island, and they didn't really have a plan for what they were going to transition to, and the locals were really concerned about that. So that was one of the things that formed, that was our genesis. The other issue was the issue of feral cats predating titi, which is the sooty shearwater or the mutton bird, out at Acres Peninsula, right at the tip. There's a small colony there. It's a really popular activity to go out and look at the birds in their breeding season, see them on the water, see them come in to land, which is a really amazing sight because they crash land into the trees and fall out. So people were taking visitors and friends out to see this site, and what they were seeing when they got to the end of the peninsula was dead birds that had been eaten by cats. So that was a really, you know, heartbreaking for people and caused the formation of our group. So our work is to pursue projects that will enhance both our community and environment. So we've got quite a broad mandate, and we nest quite a few projects underneath that. And our vision, what we would like to see, is Tiaki saddleback resident in our gardens again. So traditionally that's a bird that would have been on all of Rakiura, Stewart Island. Now there's lots of them are thriving on Olive Island, but they're just completely incompatible with rats. They spend a lot of time on the ground, and you just can't have rats in any density and have saddleback at all. So we're 9 trustees currently. I'm the chair. Our trustees have backgrounds in conservation, but also in small business and tourism administration. We're lucky to have somebody also who's very good at GIS involved. And we employ 3 staff. We employ a nearly full-time field manager, a trapping assistant, and a very, very part-time administrator. So we're currently quite a lean organisation. So this is where we do most of our work. Our main project is the Halfmoon Bay Habitat Restoration Project, which is another big mouthful. This is about creating an open sanctuary in our extended backyard so that the native wildlife can thrive. It's 210 hectares, the total project area, from the town right in the middle of the township of Oban all the way out to that peninsula at Acres Point that I talked about before. Volunteers are really the backbone of our project. You might be able to see all the different lines on this map. So that's just kind of probably half of our area. All those lines are rat trapping lines. So there's a victor rat trap every 25 metres along those lines, pretty much. We're looking to increase native birds in the area to provide a habitat that would be suitable for the reintroduction of species that have been lost, and also to educate and involve the community in conservation issues. Currently, we just trap, but we have used toxin in the past to achieve an initial knockdown. So that land is very split in kind of into little parcels. It's some of it's conservation land, some of it's large private landowners, and some of it's just small section sized, which tends to be the community. So we split that into 3 areas. We split it into our core area, which is the our best candidate for prime, pristine, predator-free bush. It's our kind of perfect habitat for kiwi, for titi, and also for the little blue penguin kōrora. In fact, we have all 3 species of New Zealand nesting penguins on Stewart Island, so we're really lucky there. Then we have a buffer zone to kind of protect that core zone. And then we have a community zone, which has got the highest density of houses, the most housing, and therefore generally the most rats, because rats unfortunately like to live with people. Just a little visual. This is our beautiful bush where we work. As you can see, it's terrible place to be. And this is one of our visiting volunteers. We rely a lot on volunteers. We're lucky to have people who want to come and stay with us and work. This is Hayden, and he's actually an osteopath, but he was taking a career break and he decided he wanted to come and trap with us for a while, and we were really grateful to have his help because he was very keen. So our pest control, 28 k's of rat and possum lines, checked weekly by field staff, so that's quite a lot for in comparison with other projects in New Zealand, I understand. We've got 21 local volunteers and visiting volunteers. So 21 volunteers out of a population of 400 is a pretty impressive strike rate, we think. So we've got some data here, kind of going back to 2003, 2004. So as you can see, initially possums were really high. We achieved an initial real knockdown of them, partly due to the fact that things like spotlighting and hunting at night used to be a little bit more permissible than they are now. But once we've got those possum numbers low, we've been able to keep them very, very low. And our monitoring shows really low numbers. Whereas the rat captures, unfortunately, is a little bit of a different story. So you can see there's some peaks and troughs. Part of what those peaks are is mast years. So our masting fruit is a tree is a remu. It's part of what kicks off the breeding cycle for the kakapo. So if you remember the good kakapo breeding season a couple of summers ago, at the same time, we were also having a mega mast of remu. But what it causes for us is an abundance of rats, unfortunately. So we do kind of our best to keep on top of those. The kind of traps we use, classic Victor snap trap on a bit of 4x2 in a core float housing to keep other birds out, to keep birds out. Trapinator possum traps, and we do also use A24 good nature self-resetting traps in some areas that are really tricky to visit regularly, steep terrain, difficult, and you know, a bit dangerous for volunteers to be going in there. So the A24s have really made a difference in terms of not having to put people out in those areas regularly, which has been fantastic. We also do feral cat control, which is quite a controversial issue. It's one that we've discussed quite a lot with our community. Our kind of thing that we keep coming back to is a feral cat is not a domestic cat. They're not the same thing, and we don't treat them the same way. So we're operating in an area where we do have cats, permitted to own a cat on Stewart Island, providing that it is neutered and microchipped. So we only use live capture cages, and we have a scanner wand to check for those microchips. And you can see in the feral cat captures graph that on the back of those rat nut booms, what you get then is a cat boom. And if you think about how many birds, 22 or 28 feral cats can eat, that's quite a, let alone, you know, the lizards and the invertebrates and the, you know, that's quite a devastating kind of impact. We're lucky to have really good regional authority rules in our area, so that desexing and microchipping is quite a hard rule in our regional pest plan. There's also a rule that you can't have own certain breeds, so Bengals are not permitted on Stewart Island. And you also are not allowed to keep or rehome feral cats. So we promote cat collars as well as the obviously required microchipping. We make them readily available because that's an easy way. Not that it's usually hard to tell a feral cat and a domestic cat apart, but that's an easy way for people to be responsible. And responsible pet ownership is really on the rise on Stewart Island. A lot of people have either completely indoor cats, cats with an outdoor enclosed run area, or cats that they keep in at least at night. Yes, so we're really embedded in our community, and we think that mostly that our stance is pretty supported. New technology is also a thing that we're really interested in. We're lucky to have some GIS expertise. So one of the things that we've been looking at as a funding stream that we've adopted last year actually is a system called Adopt a Trap, where people can go onto our website, select a trap, and effectively adopt it, and then they get a notification if that trap catches anything. It's quite a cool system. We've had 145 traps adopted in a year, which we think is pretty good. And they're really popular as gifts, actually. There's a guy who's bought each of his grandchildren. He's bought a whole line of rat traps, and he's named each one of them after each of his grandchildren. Can be hard to explain to people in different parts of the world, though, why you bought them a rat trap. We're also looking at a system called Celium that is a sort of a network node system that allows you to remotely monitor your traps. So that's giving you a notification when your trap has gone off, and that's allowing you to then lighten that physical load of having to go out and check a trap and see that it hasn't gone off. Because as anyone who watched the webinar with Sean Ryan from Cacophony Project will now know, they quite a lot of the time the predators won't go into your traps. So some traps will only catch one or two animals, maybe a ewe. We also use a trapping app. We have used a doc one called Walk the Line. So this enables our volunteers and our staff to check their traps with a phone in their pocket and then just record as they're going what's happening. Saves a lot on double handling, data entry. You don't have to have masses of Excel spreadsheets. Kind of the thing just does it itself. But the Department of Conservation has hosted Walk the Line, but unfortunately they're closing it down as of August. So we're just exploring what our next option is. Trap NZ is quite popular, but Trap NZ isn't a GIS system. It's just a recording system, so it doesn't give you that spatial information, which means for us that it's not going to play well with our Adopt a Trap system. So either we look into something GIS or we need to have a workaround for that. How are we doing? So we monitor ourselves using quarterly rat monitoring in our project area and in a control area. We do twice annual possum monitoring. We've just shifted that from residual trap catch to wax tags. We use ink cards for our monitoring. And if you can see this graph, so the red line is our control area and the blue line is our project area. Some of those results in the control area are really low. Unfortunately, we've been having an issue with possums disturbing the monitoring tunnels. For some reason, they just really badly want to get inside them and they don't fit. So they kind of bust them open. And then the wax card, the ink card is kind of wrecked and you can't really do anything with them. I don't know why they're so fascinated with going into those. But it's been quite a problem for us because our control area is quite possumy. One of the other things that's a constant for us is the struggle for funding. I'm sure many community groups can sympathise with that. So some of our funding sources from the government, we receive money from the Department of Conservation, Ministry for the Environment, lotteries, grants, weed busters. Obviously this is not all at once. This is people we've had an interaction with over 18 or 19 years of existence. Regional council, local council. We have a community trust in Southland, which have been very supportive. And Stewart Island also has a visitor levy, which we're able to access some of the funds for sometimes. And then non-governmental organisations like WWF, Project Crimson, Forest and Bird, Kiwis for Kiwis, Predator Free 2050 Inc., Tyndall Foundation. And we have quite a few good business related. Adopt a Trap, and we've got two donation boxes and often receive donations as well from passed on from local accommodation providers where a guest has said, I want to do something. to give back, which is really wonderful. So we don't just monitor rats. We also really want to monitor the things that we want to be seeing. So we conduct yearly 5-minute forest bird call counts with our local expert. And you can see the graph there for those. Ackers is the project area, and Ryan's Creek is the control. So there's consistently more birds heard in the project area than outside. We also do night bird monitoring. So our night birds is kiwi, weka, moorpark. And last year, actually, for the first time, we got some bat detectors and started monitoring bats, which was really interesting because it's believed that there's populations of both short-tail and long-tail bats on Stewart Island, but we don't know very much about them at all, and nobody seems to be really looking into that. So kiwi, we're actually quite a stronghold of kiwi due to the fact that we don't have any stoats. So you can see that our kiwi numbers there are pretty strong. We're also involved in monitoring little blue penguins, kororo. We've traditionally done that through a slow walk count, which is our volunteers walking slowly back from the peninsula at night and just counting every time they see or hear a penguin because they're really noisy. But just last year, we partnered with the New Zealand Penguin Initiative and the Halfmoon Bay school children, and we've set up 4 trail cams, which we're using to monitor penguins. And then we're going to go back and look at our slow walk count data and extrapolate from that. That's been a great experience. Our school kids are really keen because it's quite a lot of work watching all those videos and working out which one's a moth and which one's a penguin and which one's a bit of stick waving. So that's been quite a rewarding experience for us, which brings us to community involvement. That's not the only way we work with our local school. They have rat lines and we do traps with them. In general, our volunteer hours run around 2,000 a year, which is amazing for such a small population, and is probably actually a gross underestimate because a lot of people just want to do the work. They don't want to necessarily tell you how long it took them to do the work. We also do weed control. So our target weed species is Darwin's Barberry. We had 3 years of funding to do some work, and every blue and green dot on this map is a juvenile or an adult Darwin's Barberry that we controlled, and all of those yellow lines are where our people walked. So it's a pretty impressive effort. Some other projects, we run kiwi aversion training. Dogs are one of the major problems for kiwi, even the best behaved dog, due to the way a kiwi's kind of body works, can really hurt a kiwi without meaning to. So we train our local dogs twice a year. We've also got some community nursery and some revegetation projects at a local beach where the council was taking out some eucalyptus trees. What next for us? Well, currently the eternal search for funding continues, but we are looking. So currently the orange area is us. We are looking at some possible ideas for expansion if we ever had the resources. So the light blue area is Mamaku Point, so that's a fenced sanctuary. The green areas are pest-free islands, and the purple area is also where Rakiura Māori Land Trust are doing their work. So you can see there's this peninsula in between the orange and the blue one that's kind of shaded. That's an area we would like to look at as a possibility for expansion. You know, peninsulas are the new islands. It's kind of good to have that defensible thing. We're also really interested in the concept of predator-free Half Moon Bay. So because we're just out from Ackers Point, probably only about half the township is currently within our project area. So we trap around those people's houses. We do currently have a community trap library that we've had a lot of interest in and a lot of uptake for, where we loan out traps to people. But we've been starting to think, what would a predator-free Half Moon Bay look like? What if every house in Oban had a trap? You know, what would it take to support that, and what kind of benefits could that achieve? And I thought I would just finish with, this is some penguin cam footage, but it's obviously not a penguin. This is one of our Rakiura Tokueka, so this is one of our taonga species. This is kind of the reason we do the work. And I have to confess, actually, that while I was writing this presentation, I had to get up and go out and look at a kiwi on my deck. Yeah, so I guess we could probably throw it open to some questions if anyone has any. Nice.
Scroll back to your graph where you had your sort of the meeting of the two control one just before this. Yeah.
This one?
Yeah.
Our rat monitoring results?
Yeah. Yeah. Sort of thinking about March 19. Finally they came together and switched. Have any, or even in 2018, any thoughts why that beyond just your monitoring issue with possums?
There is the possibility of the monitoring. The other thing I wonder is around those mast years, is the forest richer in the control area and so more fruitful? And I just think that knowing where our control area is, it's forest as well, but it hasn't had any real, well, it has had a bit of predator control in there. So because that's March 18 we're talking about there. So that is probably, and you see there's a little peak just behind it. I wonder if the rhino, if we kind of mastered, if we got the bounce on rat numbers a bit earlier than the project, than the control area, because you see we get this, that jumps up to 57 a little bit later. And we've kind of taken the top off that peak possibly. This 12% one, I think, is actually the monitoring tunnels. But we do, in general, you would see for the amount of effort we're putting in, like that's, it would be nice to be getting a bit better results in that. And part of that, I think, is the methodology. You know, you can achieve a lot with traps, but you get to a certain point when you struggle to achieve any more.
Have you thought about intensifying or using some other mechanisms for control at the sort of your choke point of the peninsula? So having a very focused effort at the choke point rather than across the whole, so trapping elsewhere, but actually have a much more, are you even considering chemical control at your choke points?
We have thought quite seriously about that, and there's also the possibility to put, you know, there's a landowner who would be quite happy to, who at one section has a, spans the peninsula, who is, have said in the past that they're quite open to the idea of a fence. Okay. There would be a road through it, so it's not going to be perfect, but they do own quite a big chunk of land. But yeah, so that's really where we are at the moment, is considering what are the other methods, what can we do differently? Because if you keep doing the same thing, you keep getting the same results, eh?
Get to a certain stage, just going to keep tracking, I guess, rather than
having further. And we were, you know, we were talking to some fascinating people on Great Barrier about the possibility, you know, what if you've bred a generation, bred, you know, trap-averse rats over, you know, it's a long period. Rats breed in very short cycles, you know, how many generations before you do get to a rat that is just totally trap averse.
Pretty good effort for 20 people, was it? You said 20 full-time residents.
Three staff and 21 resident volunteers. We have been quite lucky with visiting volunteers. Traditionally, we've had quite a lot of international kind of backpackering, woofing types. And we really worried kind of post-COVID how that would go, because we thought, well, those people obviously aren't around anymore. But we've been really lucky that a lot of, you know, New Zealand residents who've just wanted a break from their job, or who are travelling, have wanted to come and work with us, which has been fantastic.
So where's that predator-free groups area?
So the area of the interest is the whole island. Yeah, so predator-free Rakiura is interested in the whole island. But I think, I mean, and I wouldn't want to put words in their mouth because I'm not part of that group, but I think the thinking generally now is that you do one thing in a national park where there's no people and you're doing a very different thing in a township where there is people. Because we're always, you know, that's the kind of issue for us with the toxin use as well. We're at heart a community trust. You know, the community is the backbone of what we do. You know, we're not in the business of alienating people. You know, so then you have to kind of work out, you know, is it just a vocal minority who oppose that toxin use? Or is it like a widely held kind of belief? And that's kind of hard to know because it's, you know, the loudest person in the room isn't always the most, that's not actually always a good barometer of the majority of people's views. yes, and in case I didn't kind of highlight it before, we don't have stoats. We also don't have goats or pigs. So our pest suite is rats. We've got all three. We've got the three species of rat. We've got ship rats, Norway rats, and puri, possums, feral cats, hedgehogs, and two deer species, red deer and white-tailed deer.
And what about mice?
No mice. Yep. Which is great. They think that mice do arrive eventually. I mean, people, you know, get things like barrels of pest or garden supplies shipped to the island. But they think that they don't establish because the rats eat them. Which is a little bit grim, but yeah, exactly. I mean, that is the thing as well with the cat control and the rats. You have to be a little bit careful. You know, you can't look at things in isolation. You know, you don't want to suddenly remove one element and then have something else go crazy because you've just taken that. You know, like if you take all the cats, if you wave a magic wand and take the cats away, what's that going to do? Are you going to have a massive booming rat population that's going to eat everything to the ground? You know, what's the interactions? You know, you can't just pull out a piece of the Jenga puzzle.
So no rabbits?
No rabbits. They were introduced. Somebody let some free, and they didn't establish either. I think we don't have much in the way of open ground, really. Not like the high country of the South Island. I think they just don't like those wet, damp, bushy conditions. Although I do hear that they're making inroads out in the Waitakere at the moment, so that's a bit worrying.
They love those dunes.
Yeah, yeah.
Any other challenges as a thing?
I think one that really sprung out to me actually at the Great Barrier Festival thing was there was a talk on the targeted environmental rate, and it made me really aware. I don't know if it's a remoteness thing, but where we sit within the Southland District Council, which is the biggest territorial council in New Zealand with the smallest population. So we've got a very, very narrow rating base from which to kind of fund the work you want to do. And the Auckland District Council work really hard, but it's a big region. They've got a lot to do. It's very spread out. And us being part of it, it's also Tianao, Catlins, you know, up to Balclutha on the bottom of the South Island. So a lot of the issues they're dealing with are quite different from the issues we have on Stewart Island. So I think it can be hard for them to wrap their heads around that.
Is going through the questions. I just leaves me to thank you very much, Shona. And it's been a really interesting talk, and I think it's always good for us to, it's great for us to know what else is going on in the rest of the country and hear challenges about your huge successes given the amount of people running. The nature of the project. So yeah, thank you very much.
Oh, well, thanks for having us. And we are on Facebook, so feel free to follow us on Facebook if that's your jam, or consider adopting a trap.
Yeah, no,
thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.